We are now in our 10th session, plenary session, and the title of our topic is Discipling the Nations, and there's a question, how? Our speaker is Dr. Julio Cordero Amurao. He is a Bible teacher and also a dean of the College of Theology. And he has also worked as pastor in the field under Central Luzon Conference and South Central Luzon Conference. And his wife is with us. This, where's the wife? Ninda, yes. I think she's outside. Her wife is Ninda Amurao with three children. So before we give him the time, shall we all stand for prayer? Lord, once again, we come to you. We are about to start our session. We would like to ask you to please be with each one of us, that the things that we're going to hear, the things that we're going to receive, will help us to be a better Christian and to enable us to make disciples for Christ. Be with us, O Lord. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Let's now give the time to Dr. Amurao.
Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat. Good afternoon to each one of you. I would like to give a background why I have come to this presentation, Discipling the Nations and How. There are many ways, perhaps there are many books giving suggestions on how to finish the work of God here on earth. When I was studying here in AIIAS, I took some courses in leadership. I am in the line of applied theology, and I have heard a lot of work and presentation about servant leadership. And then one day, we were assigned to make a paper, and I come across with a concept, and that is what we call missional leadership. Okay? Missional leadership. And I come to understand that this kind of leadership should hand in hand be the experience of our pastors and leaders in the field. Having the example of Jesus as leaders, but as pastors and teachers, we have to be and we have to become visionary. We should have a vision. And our vision actually is to finish the work given to us by Jesus Christ. Okay? And that is what we call missional leadership. And so from then on, it has been my passion and my goal in life. As I teach, I give the challenge to my students, do not just be a servant leader. Be a missional leader. And so, because of my passion, because of my conviction to share this missional leadership concept, I have come up with this presentation, Discipling the Nations, How? Every member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church should be concerned about the missiological purpose of our last day's church. We know that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a prophetic church. We know that our message, we have a prophetic message. And we are also aware, brothers and sisters, that we have our prophetic mission. Okay? It's very clear in Revelation chapter 14, the three angels' message. The church in prophecy with the prophetic message and a prophetic mission in the last days. And so, from the time of our inception, our establishment as a church, we have been waiting for the second coming of Jesus Christ, right? And let me read. Is it enough for us Seventh-day Adventists to be constantly expecting for the coming of Jesus? Is it enough to watch for the signs of the times and confirm their fulfillment? What about the missiological purpose of our prophetic church? It is the purpose of this presentation to identify and describe the three prevailing attitudes among the Seventh-day Adventists, at least in my observation here in the Philippines, the three attitudes among the Seventh-day Adventists and their relationship with the second coming of Jesus Christ. Then, describe the condition of the apostolic church in their story of fulfilling their mission. Then, identify and describe the lessons from the missiological experience of the disciples. And finally, give suggestions relevant to the fulfillment of our mission in the end of time. The three attitudes. The name Seventh-day Adventist Church bears our main message. We are a people waiting for the second advent of Jesus Christ, and we are keeping the seventh day as our day of worship. And we have substantial evidences from the Bible to serve as our basis in these beliefs, and thus our teachings are biblical indeed. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is constantly focused on the second coming of Jesus in their preaching and also in their teaching. From the time of our pre- and post-establishment as an organized church by the government, its members in different times, in different decades, and even until now, believe, and we still believe, that the signs of the times, the signs of the second coming of Jesus Christ are being fulfilled. In the publications, in the sermons of Seventh-day Adventists, in different times, different decades, the religious, political, social, moral conditions were presented as fulfillment of the prophecy in Matthew chapter 24. Today, we are aware, much attention is given to the call of unity between the Catholic Church and other Protestant denominations. However, there is one prophecy that is left and yet to be fulfilled, and that is world evangelization. Okay, in Matthew 24, we can observe different times, different decades, we have been focusing on the fulfillment of the signs of the times. And if there is one sign that is yet to be fulfilled, that is world evangelization. Observation shows that there are three kinds of attitudes among Adventist preachers and believers as far as the second coming is concerned. Number one, we have the revivalist. The revivalist, revivalist is defined as one who revives or restores something disused. In the church, a revivalist focuses on the signs of the times and the work of transformation that is necessary to be ready for the coming of Jesus. Those who are very much concerned about revival and reformation. Now, a revivalist seems to be very careful and even extra careful in many things that would fit him or fit her for translation in heaven or going to heaven. And then the second one, a pragmatist. A pragmatist believes that the meaning of conceptions is to be sought in their practical bearings, that the function of thought is to guide action, and the truth is preeminently to be tested by the practical consequences of belief. Okay, is it practical? Okay, is it beneficial? So, thus, a pragmatist focuses on relevance and how to practically cope with the present trend and passion of the day. And because they are being so practical, that person, for example, he seems careless in relating Bible teaching and its practice, and sometimes unmindful of the Bible truth. They may present the prophecy, or they may represent the prophecy in Revelation chapter 3 about the lukewarm condition of the church. Now, let's go to the third group or third kind of attitude. Those who are concerned about mission, the missiologists. Now, here is how I define it. The missiological focus, all right, they may present now. The missiologists focuses on world evangelization. Okay? He reflects and thinks of Christ's words in Matthew 24, verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached throughout the world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end shall come. There is a need for many of us to be aligned with the attitude and view of a missiologist. Of these three, we must choose the spirit and attitude of the revivalist anyway, right? But we must shun and eradicate the attitude of the pragmatist being lukewarm. But I would like to recommend that we should extend and enhance the behavior of the missiologist. We must be concerned for the transformation of character and further be wholeheartedly engrossed with our passion for mission. Indeed, there is a work to do both inside and outside of the church. The transformation inside should move us with compassion and lead us to carry on God's mission outside, even to the big outside world. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit as a result of revival will not immediately be followed by the second coming of Jesus Christ. All right? As Adventists, we are aware about the teaching of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Some of us are aware of what we call the outpouring of the latter rain. But we know, if we are going to look at the writings of Ellen G. White, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in the form of the latter rain, immediately, or shall we say, the second coming will not follow immediately after that. One of the reasons for the outpouring of the latter rain is for world evangelization. And so, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit as a result of revival will not immediately be followed by the second coming of Jesus Christ. Persecution, martyrdom would happen as many would testify before the course of men. Spirit-filled men and women powerfully and unashamedly witness, just like Stephen, and many will be called to stand for the truth. Thus, the spiritual refreshing will be given to empower the people of God for world evangelization. Now, how does the church par with the world evangelization? Where are we? Statistics are varied. It depends on the book, it depends on the year, and the source that you are actually reading. One that is available shows that 1 billion of the 1.6 billion of the world's population do not know about the gift of salvation being offered by Jesus Christ. Now, among the Christians, we have the 18 million 70 Adventists whose conviction about their prophetic calling, about their prophetic message, and about their prophetic end time mission, sorry to say, it's not very clear to many Seventh-day Adventists. All right? Our prophetic calling, our prophetic message, and our prophetic mission are not clearly understood by many of our members. With this condition, plus the fast-growing population rate in the world, how can the task of world evangelization be fulfilled? Do we need more departments? What do you think? Do you think we need more programs? Do you think we need more institutions? Do you think we need more training in the church? What should be the answer? The church is in the right direction in having these things for world evangelization. However, we should look at the experience of the apostolic church on how they carry out the gospel commission to the then civilized world during the outset, during the beginning of the Christian church. Okay? We should look at the experience of the apostolic church and how they carry out the gospel commission to the then civilized world during the outset of the Christian church. This is from the book of Ellen G. White, The Acts of the Apostles. The disciples prayed with intense earnestness for the fitness to meet men and in their daily intercourse to speak words that would lead sinners to Christ. Hindi pala makakarugtong. These days of preparation were days of heart searching and yes, confessing and repentance. And so, those who are concerned about revival, they focus on this part of the writings of Ellen G. White. But they should move on. The disciples felt their spiritual need and cried to the Lord for the holy action that was to fit them for the work of what? Soul saving. They did not ask for a blessing for themselves merely. Let's move on. They were weighted with what? The burden of salvation of souls. They realized that the gospel was to be carried where? To the world. And they claimed the power that Christ had promised. I was talking a while ago, yesterday, I was talking with someone, and I told him, you see, I think and I believe that the members of the church should be made aware about mission, about world evangelization. Talking about our evangelism and our mission, this is our tendency. We tend to look in finishing the work of God in our own territory. It's about natural, right? We have our own territory. But remember, brothers and sisters, the commission given to us by Jesus Christ is evangelize the world. The whole world. And we are not, sometimes we fail, okay, to give this awareness and challenge to the members of the church. Let's move on. So, based on the passage, they were all concerned. In the beginning of the Christian church, every member, 120 of them in the upper room, they were all concerned about their mission to the world. What about the members of the church today? Are all members concerned about mission? That is the challenge for a Christian leader and a Christian teacher. Now, continue. Take note. Take note that all of them prayed. God poured out the promised power of the Holy Spirit. Consequently, signs and wonders aided some of them in their mission. What happened? They were all concerned about their mission to the world. They all become missionary-minded, and they as one person unitedly pray how to carry out their mission into the world. And because of that burden, what happened? God poured out the promised power of the Holy Spirit, and consequently, signs and wonders aided some of them in their mission. You see, what's the result? language. Dr. Dison is aware of the fact how important language is in mission. Language is very important in mission. But you see, in the twinkling of an eye, after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, language was not a problem. Amen? In mission, language is one potential barrier. It takes time, it takes effort to learn foreign language. Greek, Hebrew, wow! Hebrew and Greek. But in this case, God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, did miracle and wonders in both the hearing and the speaking of the disciples and in the hearing of the people from different countries. They were able to hear about Jesus and understood the message. In the single preaching of Peter that day, 3,000 souls were baptized. And the church grew tremendously. Thousands were added to the fold. Thousands were added and they believed in Jesus Christ. And then later on, according to the record, and I did not write the citation here, churches were multiplied from addition going to multiplication. And the final account, I think this was presented to us by Dr. Habian yesterday, in Acts chapter 17, they turned the world upside down. They turned the world upside down. And this could mean that the good news about Jesus Christ was made known in the civilized world then. And that is, through the power of the Holy Spirit, they spoke different languages. Thousands added. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, they spoke different languages. They healed the deaf, the mute, the lame, and the blind. And before going further, you will remember the experience of the disciples when they are about to pass a certain barangay. The families, they used to put their loved ones who are sick along the way. Why? By mere shadow of the disciples, people got healed. Signs and wonders through the power of the Holy Spirit. Later on, in the record in the book of Acts, Peter and Paul, they were given the power to raise the dead. Go back to the experience of Peter when he raised Tabitha back to life. The whole community believed in Jesus Christ. Signs and wonders. What else? In the book of Acts chapter 8, this is about the experience of Philip. You will notice that directly the Holy Spirit and the angels, they are communicating with Philip. What to do? Where to go? Power of the Holy Spirit, 5 minutes. All right? Philip was carried by the Holy Spirit to Azotus later for another mission. Now, they were able to fulfill the commission of Jesus in the beginning of Christianity through the power of the Holy Spirit. I'll go fast now. Now, in one part of my paper, I wrote, great was the result of the early rain, but greater will be the result of the latter rain. Thus, this is the solution. How? It is through the power of the Holy Spirit that the world evangelization could be realized. I think nobody can contest me in that. But the challenge now is, how are we going to lead our members to become missionary-minded? You see, according to John Dibdal, there are three things that everyone, every person, every believer can do for mission. And the initial is GGP. Go, give, and pray. Okay? Only these three things. Go, give, and pray. But
to the level of participation, only some can go. Only some can join the Philippine Frontier Mission. Right? I cannot go to China personally. But some can give. Many can give, I should say. Many can give. Okay, they are supporting the missionaries going to different places. But look at the last one. All can pray for God's mission. All can pray for God's mission. Through prayer, we can lead our members to become missionary-minded. Education and awareness. Everybody can be involved in the work of mission through prayer. We need only to teach them the structure and the subjects that need to be included in prayer. How? Prayer partnership. Prayer partnership in our churches, in different departments of our church. Now, what to pray for? For example, these two. Okay? Pastor Ron and our brother here. You will become prayer partners and you are going to pray for each other's concern. Okay? What else? You are going to include in your prayer one local or international missionary entity of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It could be the 1,000 missionary movement. Why so fast? Missionary, 1,000 missionary movement, Adventist Frontier Mission, Philippine Frontier Mission, missionary Maranatha volunteers, or any other missionary entity in your context. And then we should include in our prayers any of the unreached people in the world. Look at this one. How many of you are praying for your loved ones? All of us, right? But how many of you are praying for the loved ones of the Lord? And when I ask loved ones of the Lord, it's like this. The loved ones of the Lord include the Muslims, the Buddhists, the Hindus, and other growing religions and people groups in the world. Our members should be made aware of their existence. They should be included in their vision. Make disciples of all nations. Here is the mechanics. Its prayer partner will agree to pray at their designated time or in conjunction with the 7-7 prayer program of the General Conference. But if they see that it's not quite applicable in their schedule, set another schedule. Schedule convenient to both of you. You don't need to be together. Even though, for example, I'm here in AIIAS and my partner is in AUP in our agreed time. For example, every 9 o'clock, rest assured, I'll be praying for you and you'll be praying for me. My concern. And not only that, I'm going to include in our prayer, they should be specific in their prayer partnership. They can agree to pray for each other, it depends on you. How long should we be partners with each other? 1 month, 2 months? It depends on both of you. You make the agreement. And then they can agree to pray for each other for a month or more. Choose one missionary group, include the Philippine Frontier Mission, and Brother Abner will be happy about it. All right? Whatever missionary group, and choose one foreign religion to be included in your prayer. Remember, and I believe in this, a Christian is being fashioned, molded, influenced by the things that he or she is praying for. Amen? This is what God longs to see into his people, all together missionary-minded. And when God sees that we are all focusing in His work, I believe, brothers and sisters, the church is ready to receive the power of the Holy Spirit in the form of the latter rain. And when it happens, I could not imagine what God can do through Spirit-filled Christian members of the church. I was asking my contemporaries and my other co-pastors, can you recall in the Old Testament if there is any prophecy that the disciples will speak different language? And they could not. What we have in the Old Testament is the prophecy that they will receive the Holy Spirit. But what the Holy Spirit will do and can do through them, it was not prophesied in the Old Testament. What's the point? We cannot imagine, brothers and sisters, what God can do through a Spirit-filled Christian. Remember Philip? He was taken by the Holy Spirit. The unreached places, unreached people, if we are filled with the Holy Spirit, God can just bring us to these people. Spirit-filled Christians, signs and wonders. How are we going to disciple the nations? Spirit-filled Christians, through the power of the Holy Spirit. We have to educate and we have to make our members aware of the mission of God. Let us teach them and lead them to pray for God's mission. If every department in the church, if every institution in our church, if every church in the Seventh-day Adventist mission and conferences will teach and make our members aware about the mission of God, praying about God's mission, my conviction and my belief, brothers and sisters, is the Holy Spirit will be poured upon us in the form of the latter rain. Great was the result of the early rain. That was in the beginning of Christianity. Ours, okay? Prophetic church, ours is the conclusion. Ours is the conclusion. And greater will be the result of the latter rain, the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. Now is the time for question and answer. Our speaker is ready to receive your questions. Is there any? Anyone would like to ask? Maybe, sir, I'd like to throw the first question. And concerning the global evangelization, what can you say about these OFWs, Overseas Filipino Workers? Are they a good group of people that could carry out the gospel to the world?
The awareness and the challenge to educate our members about the mission of the church, okay, the mission of the church, and the role of every leader, okay, to lead and to teach every member to become missionary-minded through this prayer partnership. It will take care of everything. Kasi what I have in mind is like this. What amount of program and approaches, okay, what amount of program and approaches would equal a Spirit-filled Christian? Nothing. So our main concern actually is this. We should lead the members of the church actually to be missionary-minded, and this is through this prayer partnership. And when every one of us, just like the disciples, all of them were concerned about mission, evangelization of the world. And if many of the members of the church is so much concerned, every member is so much concerned, my belief and my conviction is then the church is ready to receive the power. And when the power is poured upon us, again, I do not know what kind of approach. It will just follow. I believe it will just follow. Remember Philip? taken by the Holy Spirit. Okay? Going to Asutus. And according to the experts, if you are going to see the distance from that place going to Asutus, it will take 3 days' journey. Oh, you can even travel around the world by our modern technology, right? But you see, taken by the Holy Spirit. And I believe he was taken by the Holy Spirit to a community and group of people ready to be harvest, ready to listen to the message of salvation. That the Holy Spirit can do.
Hello, hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Dr. Amurao, and I am fully convinced that it is really through the power of the Holy Spirit that will be able to evangelize the world. I remember one author saying that the kind of people we have in the church, or we will be able to attract people outside, or the kind of people we have in the church will be able to attract people with the same kind to get inside the church. My point is, this is my personal observation. It seems to me that the church today, including myself, is not very much ready into this kind of work and thinking. And sometimes we are comforted with the idea that because we are in the last days and we belong to the Laodicean church, that's why we are like this, because we belong to the Laodicean church. My question is, how can we as a church? Because basically, you know, up there in the leadership, there are good programs, there are good challenges given to the people, but basically, those who frontliners, who are in the frontliners, the church members, the grassroots, those who are in the grassroots, they are the ones, you know, doing really, literally the work. My question is, how can we change the direction, and how can we shift the paradigm? Because unless we change the thinking of the members, you know, we do the same thing, you know, no matter what encouragement and presentations we have, you know, we go back to the same thinking.
Okay. Brethren, improvement begins with letter I. Improvement begins with letter I. If you are convinced, and if you are convicted that we need to be aware, and that we need to be and to become missionary-minded, and that we can lead every member of the church to become missionary-minded simply by praying, you can start where you are, even here in AIIAS. I challenge you, why not start here? In the light and in the challenge of what I've shared with you, you can do this. And as you go along in different parts of the world, after you have been partnered with somebody, you can be also partnered with another person. It's like a virus, right? Lead people to become missionary minded through prayer. And you see, if you'll be able to lead people to become missionary minded through prayer, then the second one will follow. Some will give, or many will give. And then the next, again, step will follow. Some will be convinced to go. So, you know what? I mentioned a while ago in my introduction that as leader, and as a teacher, and many of us are leaders in the church, our big burden, our concern should be how are we going to lead and to teach our members to be involved in the mission of the church? How many percent of our members are concerned about mission? Very few. Why? Why? Perhaps because we who should lead them fail to lead them sometimes. Prayer is just an ordinary thing, but we can make use of prayer in leading our members of the church to become missionary-minded. Improvement, again, how? Improvement begins with letter I. You can start it by yourself. So, my challenge is, if you are convicted, even right now, you can make an agreement with your seatmate. Starting tonight, let us pray. I'll pray for you, and let us pray for Maranatha volunteers. Let us pray for PFM, Philippine Frontier Mission. Let us pray for Adventist Frontier Mission. Let us pray for missionaries of the 1,000 missionary movement. And do you know what, young brothers and sisters? It's not easy to be a missionary. It's not easy. Why cannot we pray for them? Why can't we pray for them? You pray for your loved ones? Why are we not praying for the loved ones of the Lord? How many are praying for the Buddhists, for example, in Thailand? For the Buddhists in India? Why can't we include them in their prayer? Can we do that? We can. But we are not doing that. Because our concept and our idea of mission is sometimes too domesticated among us. And we do not realize that the mission given to us by God is go and make disciples of all nations. I hope I answered the question.
Uno, dos.
Most Adventists in the world, I guess about 80% of Adventists live in Latin America, Sub-Saharan Africa, Philippines, and Pacific Islands.
Yes.
Some reports boast that Adventists have reached 200 countries in the world. However, when we look closely to the numbers, we will realize that some of those entered countries have only 50 or 100 Adventists. The truth is that we have not successfully fulfilled our mission in the world. There is too much that we have to do basically in Asia and post-Christian Europe and Canada and Australia. However, when we mention this challenge to some members, at least in Dominican Republic, they only say, oh, we'll just wait for the latter rain. When that happens, then we'll fulfill the mission.
Okay.
Nevertheless, many non-Adventist Christians are not waiting for the latter rain. They are actually spending time, money, and people sending them to the unreached countries of the world. My question is, how can we help our church members realize the need not to think only locally,
yeah,
but understand that our mission includes also those faraway countries or even places in our own country that have not been reached, while also assuring them that we actually believe in Ellen White's writings, but that we do not need to wait for the later rains in order to fulfill our mission as a remnant church.
Yeah, that's true. Now, as I said a while ago, according to John Dibdal, there are three action words that we can do for God's mission. Go, give, and pray. Some can go. Many can give. But I venture in the possibility of making our members aware you can pray for God's mission. Everybody can pray. And my thesis actually is going back to the experience of the disciples in the upper room. All of them prayed.
all of them were so concerned about God's mission. The point actually is, we should prepare the people and they should be ready for the outpouring of the power. For the outpouring of the power. No amount of program would equate the power of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that's what we need. Now, for example, every church, AIIAS church. What if what we are going to do is really make the structure? Who is your partner? You talk together. Effect the change. Anyway, this is not very hard, I think. By twos, that's the simplest structure in the Bible. When Jesus Christ sent his disciples, by twos. And it depends on your covenant with each other. You will be reminding each other, and you see, if you will be praying about God's mission, then it will become a part of you, a part of every member of the church. We need to lead into this direction all the members of the church. This is not very hard. Now, for example, the church, without thinking about mission, who should initiate? If it happens that you will be there, a speaker or a teacher, a pastor in the church, then initiate the change. Or perhaps right now, if you are convinced, I'm telling you, if you are convinced, turn to your partner. Make the covenant. He will be your prayer partner for 1 month or two. And then you can mention about your each other's concern. Pray for a missionary entity. Pray for unreached territory for a month. Awareness about God's mission. Okay? So the same thing that I can give as my answer. You see, I said a while ago na as a teacher and as a pastor, our burden should be how are we going to involve, okay? How are we going to lead our members to become involved in God's mission? All can pray. But you see, we have our revival and reformation prayer, 7-7-7. But I have noticed that, yes, that's a good program of the church, worldwidely. Take note. In the 7-7 prayer, did you notice the concern about God's mission? It seems to me, I do not know, I hope I'm wrong. The prayer for revival and reformation sometimes, what's coming in the mind of Adventists is, after the revival and reformation, Jesus Christ will come and will be translated to heaven. What about the world? Many and millions of people who have not yet known Jesus Christ. The Great Commission is just before us, brothers and sisters. And we need the same power given to the disciples. In the beginning of Christianity, in the introduction of Christianity, now we are in the conclusion. The same power is needed by the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Last time? Okay, maybe we can accommodate one last question. Pastor Lee?
Thank you, Dr. Amurao, for the presentation. I totally agree with your emphasis on the prayer.
Yes, thank you.
I would like to mention one thing. It's the second thing you mentioned, yes. Give. Many can give, right? So I think this word many, including each one of us here. How can we give? I would like to challenge each one of you one small thing. Tracts giving. It's very simple. You just go to your local church and get some good tracts. And then when you go to a market, Robinson, SM, when you buy anything, and after you pay the money, give a tract to the cashier, and then with a smiling face, and say, "This is a small gift for you." I think this one is very easy, but I think many of us don't do that. Can we all not only pray from today, pray for the missionaries,
yes,
only also one more thing, bring the tracts together with you,
yeah,
when you go out, please, because they all need gospel. Making disciples is with action, of course, with prayer. And one last thing I want to mention is a very sad thing. Some churches, you cannot find good tracts. Some churches, they just hide their tracts and put in the store. When I went to a church and asked for some tracts, they went to the store and get some tracts with a lot of dust. And then, you understand what I'm saying? And some churches don't have tracts at all. Sorry to tell you this thing. Please, if you are a pastor, if you are a leader in the church, buy some good tracts. God needs these tracts to win people. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. He asked the question how to give, and he answered it already. May I request the PFM, if we have PFM workers here, do we have? May I request them to please stand up? PFM. Here are some of our missionaries going to the actual battlefield, brothers and sisters. If you want to give for mission, you can support them. Some can go, many can give, but all can pray for God's mission. God bless us all.
Pastor Leah, I'd like to hand over the certificate to Dr. Amurao.
Yes, on behalf of the AIIAS 18 Theological Society, I would like to present this certificate of appreciation to Dr. Julio Amurao. Thank you so much for your presentation.